Our understanding of migraine pathophysiology has accelerated over the past decade with advances in genetic analysis, animal models, and imaging. Nonetheless, as we take a journey into a migrainer's brain, there remain significant gaps in our knowledge. The hallmark of migraine disease is repeated episodes of intense headache, often with nausea, light sensitivity, and other sensations. Although there are blood vessels and inflammatory cells involved in migraine disease, it is essentially a neurological disorder. In other words, certain triggers such as food, light, sound, touch, stress, and sleep disturbance send signals to the brain. And for a migrainer, that's just enough to set off a headache. However, a growing body of information is challenging us to broaden our interpretation of what a migraine is. Already it's clear that there are many forms of migraine, but the full breadth of the spectrum has yet to be determined. So let's look at what we do know. It appears that migrainers are born with a defective nervous system, at least some portion of it. How this works has been difficult to figure out because migraine disease is not one or two gene mutations, but more than 20. An example of a genetic defect is a locus designed to produce the protein structure of a calcium ion channel. These genetic neural defects have an effect on the nerves that sense our world, and none more strongly than the trigeminal nerve. The trigeminal nerve has three branches: the ophthalmic branch that supplies sensation to the eyes, lining of the nose, and forehead; the maxillary branch that innervates the midface, lower nose, and paranasal sinuses; and the mandibular branch, which covers the teeth and jaw. The ophthalmic and maxillary branches send fibers to the meninges. When the sensors on the forehead, within a paranasal sinus, or around the temporomandibular joint are triggered, signals are relayed along the trigeminal nerve back to the trigeminal nucleus in the trigemino-cervical complex of the brainstem. Think of a brain nucleus as a transfer station in an electrical grid where the signal can be strengthened and redirected to other parts of the brain. From the brainstem, neurologic activity can potentially affect several different aspects of the central nervous system. One of these pathways follows the trigeminal nerves to the dura and its blood vessels. When stimulated, these trigeminal nerves release neurotransmitters in the dura: serotonin, neurokinin A, substance P, glutamate, and calcitonin gene-related protein, CGRP. CGRP has several functions, including stimulating mast cells. The mast cells release histamine that cause an inflammatory reaction, including the production of nitric oxide within vascular endothelial cells. The nitric oxide then stimulates the perivascular sensory nerves and causes vasodilation. Other chemicals, noradrenaline, prostaglandins, inflammatory cytokinins, flood the dura. Together, these chemicals cause pain and swelling across the sensitive covering of the brain. This theory, called peripheral sensitization, is one of the mechanisms of an acute throbbing migraine headache. Following the local inflammation and swelling of the dura, the trigeminal nerves react by sending signals back to the trigeminal nucleus, and a whole new series of chemical events follow, now in the midbrain. Within the trigeminal nucleus, substance P and CGRP are released. They cause pain within the deep portions of the brain. Other neurotransmitters, serotonin and glutamate, are injected into the system, producing additional pain and inflammatory agents. Nitric oxide, C-reactive protein, and cytokinins. Soon, the trigeminovascular system of the brainstem lights up with a sterile inflammatory reaction. Sterile because it's not related to an infection. Unfortunately, recent studies illustrate the gap between theory and reality. It was a huge disappointment when drugs designed to block the receptors of neurokinin A and substance P failed to reduce the pain of a migraine headache. The trigeminal nucleus can be compared to a major call center in a neural telecommunication system. It has circuits that join pathways from other systems in the body via the quintothalamic tract on their way up to the thalamus and cerebral cortex. The thalamus plays a critical part in generating migraine pain, auras, and chronic forms of migraine. Perhaps the most intriguing part of this theory is that inflammation of the thalamus may corrupt many other neural pathways. Functional radiology shows activity in several midbrain nuclei: the dorsal raphe nucleus, the locus coeruleus, the nucleus raphe magnus. These specialized nerve centers all modulate pain, but they also have other functions. The dorsal raphe nucleus, with its high concentration of serotonin-controlled synapses, plays an important role in the feelings of depression and anxiety. The locus coeruleus is a nucleus located in the pons, and it controls stress, balance, mood, sleep, and autonomic system. The pulvinar nucleus of the thalamus synchronizes activities between the cortical areas and regulates information across the visual cortex. This could well be the area generating visual auras. The anterior cingulate cortex controls our self-perception, including a wide range of cognitive, motor, pain, and emotional functions. It is strongly linked to the brainstem, hypothalamus, amygdala, and periductal gray, as well as the autonomic motor nuclei. There are also the descending neural pathways, known as the monoamine system. These neural bundles, located in the brainstem and midbrain, regulate the sensory signals as they pass from the spinal cord to the supraspinal centers where pain is processed. The system contains both inhibitory neurons, mediated by noradrenaline, and excitatory neurons, sensitive to serotonin. Beyond its effect on pain, a dysfunction of either noradrenaline or serotonin can affect sleep, depression, or anxiety. It is within the midbrain that common genetic defects, or simply spillover from adjacent neural activity, might explain why migraine sufferers have so many more complaints than just headaches. For example, to understand the overlap of migraine and sinusitis, one must be aware of the two different sensors in the sinus mucosa. There are both fast pain fibers, a source of sharp, intense pain, and slower, unmyelinated fibers, responsible for the sensation of pressure. A problem with either sensor can create a feeling of relentless pain or pressure with only a minimal or no correlation to what is really happening inside the sinuses. At the same time, at the level of the trigeminal nucleus, there can be cross-stimulation of the superior salivatory nucleus. This nerve center then sends parasympathetic signals via the facial nerve and the pterygopalatine ganglion to the lining of the nose where blood vessels dilate and the inferior turbinates swell, and where secretory glands pump out watery mucus. In this fashion, migraine disease has created an illusion of sinusitis that is very real to the patient and difficult to distinguish from sinus infection or inflammation by the clinician. In fact, to make the correct diagnosis more challenging, a mild degree of inflammation within a sinus might trigger symptoms that are out of proportion to the condition. Another consequence of the midbrain activity is the generation of a wave of electric activity across the surface of the cortex called a cortico-spreading depression. When stimulated, afferent nerve endings in the trigeminal nerve send a stimulus to the dorsal rostral pons. This midbrain nucleus sends signals to the posterior cortex. Across the occipital cortex, an arc of electrical activity appears and slowly moves across the brain at a rate of 3 millimeters per minute. This wave is followed by a quiet level of neural activity. But substance P, nitric oxide, neurokinin A, and CGRP are released. Substance P causes plasma to leak from vessels, thus creating edema. CGRP and neurokinin A cause blood vessels to constrict and blood oxygen levels to drop. Cortical spreading depressions are thought to be important in the creation of auras, those painless experiences of light sensitivity, nausea, slow gastrointestinal motility, muddled thinking, and exhaustion. Some symptoms of migraine disease also evolve over time, from an episodic event to a more smoldering chronic condition, often with fewer headaches but more debilitating, ebbing and flowing symptoms. Change in migraine disease appears to be related to three major factors: a genetic predisposition, neuro and vascular injuries to the central nervous system caused by repeated acute headaches, and fluctuations in hormone levels. The best understood example of the collateral stimulation of the brain during an acute migraine attack is cutaneous allodynia. Cutaneous allodynia means normal touch of the skin elicits pain. It affects about 80% of migrainers. This transient phenomenon usually starts at the height of a migraine headache and then disappears. It is referred to as central sensitization. It is thought that repeated showers of inflammatory and neurotransmitter chemicals cause permanent damage and a change to the central nervous system. For example, with cutaneous allodynia, a reduced threshold to touch during an acute migraine attack evolves into an independent chronic hypersensitivity. For some people, that means combing hair or wearing clothes becomes an everyday annoyance or pain. This biological phenomenon appears to affect more than the nerves controlling touch. For example, the brainstem contains a network of interoceptive circuits that control how we feel about ourselves. A critical component in the subconscious circuitry is the diencephalon, of which the thalamus is the largest component. Within the thalamus are the anterior cingulate cortex and pulvinar that initiate cortical spreading depressions. Chronic inflammatory damage is thought to leave these nuclei sending unprovoked signals to the cortex and resulting in repeated headaches, much like a faulty fire alarm. This is considered one of the possible mechanisms of chronic migraine headaches. Connections from the pulvinar nucleus to the auditory, somatosensory, and visual cortex may begin to explain not only headaches, but some of the many other odd, painless sensations associated with migraine. In other words, other neural connections from the thalamus to adjacent midbrain nuclei cause disruptions in the normal function of the autonomic system, sleep cycles, anxiety, depression, visceral activity, balance, hearing, olfaction, and taste. Perhaps, just as with acute migraine attacks, chronic abnormal sensitization of the midbrain has a ripple effect. On top of this complex shadowy picture, we have to overlay the multiple metabolic effects of sex hormones: estradiol, progesterone, and estrogen. The major effects are thought to be those of estrogen. One example of how estrogen works is its effect on the enzyme COMT. Consider this enzyme our friend because it breaks down epinephrine. Epinephrine is our enemy because it makes us more sensitive to pain. So, when there's an increase in estrogen, it reduces the production of our friendly COMT. Consequently, epinephrine goes up and our headache gets worse. Estrogen has many effects on our brain. For example, at the level of the synapse, it alters the effectiveness of serotonin as a neurotransmitter. but many of the effects we still do not understand. Part of the complexity of hormones is that they pass freely through cell membranes, and there are different steroid receptors on both cell membranes and the nucleus. The consequence is that they are able to produce neuroinflammatory proteins. What's more, there have been several genetic defects of steroid receptors identified in migrainers. Unfortunately, sympathy for migrainers is affected by our inability to see most of the effects of their disease. Importantly, it's rarely appreciated that migraine is a chronic inflammatory multisystem disease that includes increased morbidity. There is roughly 2 times higher risk of stroke in women with migraines and auras. Although there are many disease processes that appear to cause white matter hyperintensities, the finding of deep white matter hyperintensities in a migrainer may be residue from chronic cerebrovascular inflammation. White matter hyperintensities are bright signal findings on T2 MRI images, best demonstrated in flare sequences. They can appear at all stages in life, but appear to increase with aging. They are essentially degradation of either neurons or blood vessels of the brain. They represent a range of ischemic tissue damage from dilated perivascular spaces to marked arteriosclerosis. One hypothesis is that repeated sterile vascular inflammation associated with corticospreading depressions results in endothelial injury of the cranial blood vessels. Other evidence points to the same genetic abnormalities associated with migraine auras as the cause of defects in blood vessels of the brain. These defective chromosomes, perhaps combined with hormonal influences, put women at greater risk of cerebrovascular disease. Although there remains uncertainty about the pathophysiology and significance of white matter lesions, they occur almost 4 times as frequently in migrainers than in the general population. Therefore, they can be nonspecific markers of possible migraine disease when noted as an incidental MRI finding. While we have speculated on a larger role for migraine to explain symptoms beyond an acute headache, there are still gaps in our understanding of migraine pathophysiology, such as the relevance of glutamate and mitochondria in the disease process. Moreover, we lack useful diagnostic tools to identify migraine disease and often fail to provide a suitable treatment. And finally, we don't even know the boundaries of what we call migraine disease.